The right to appeal gun cases. We don't have that in suppression hearings. If, you know, a gun is suppressed as a state, we don't have the ability of appealing that. Right. But if it's related to drugs, we can. So that's something that we're going to be pushing for. I can say that my number one sort of legislative priority, and I'm pushing and urging Senator Zirkin to do something with, is the Repeat Sexual Predator Prevention Act. We've been pushing this legislation for the past 5 years. And in the time of the Me Too movement, we need to do more.
That is Baltimore City State's Attorney Marilyn Mosby talking about a comprehensive crime bill that the state Senate is expected to debate this week, will probably give final approval to. She was on the C4 show today. C4 back better than ever.
Yes, sir.
Good to have you back.
Thank you, sir.
What do you make of this bill and also Marilyn Mosby's take on it?
Well, the fact that now Annapolis has kind of focused on assisting Baltimore City, not just with enhanced penalties for violent crime, but also in reference to witness intimidation money. The state's attorney mentioned that part of this bill, and State Senator Zirkin called in right after the state's attorney was on the show, Senator Zirkin did, talking about there is money in this bill to assist in witnesses who are trying to get repeat violent felons off the street. The Safe Streets money, the program that we know has been effective in the city, there's money in there for that.
Talmadge Branch has made expanding that program tribute to his grandson.
In the House is actually named that way. And so the bottom line is, I look at the fact that Baltimore being designated the most dangerous city in America by USA Today, maybe that helped push a lot of action in Annapolis, particularly towards helping the city.
Some of Governor Hogan's ideas are also included in this.
Correct.
Doug Mayer has said that the governor is happy with what has been done, although he's disappointed some of the governor's things weren't included.
Well, they didn't do mandatory minimums. We're going to talk with the
mandatory minimums,
about that tomorrow. Governor Larry Hogan's on the show tomorrow. And what they did was, what Senator Zirkin said, they put enhanced penalties in there. So while it's not mandatory minimums, like if you have an armed robbery, for instance, it's 15 years, they've enhanced that to 25 years.
The Judiciary Committees in both the Senate and House don't like mandatory minimums. Mostly because it takes away
ties the hands of the judges,
prosecutors and judges, and they like, you know, they hear complaints from the judges that judges have to have the final say here.
But Robert, we saw in many instances last year the judiciary really unwilling to explain how repeat violent offenders keep getting on the streets in earlier dates. And so while the governor did not get mandatory minimums, I believe the enhanced element of this and sentences speaks to some frustration with the judiciary and where they kind of are in this.
You and I are among the frequent users of Maryland Judiciary Case Search, and a lot of reporters use it, a lot of activists use
public information.
It's public information. Basically, all the information you need about a particular defendant, and if you can see if somebody's been charged, somebody's been tried, the outcome of it, it would also include the names of the police officers,
sure,
the arresting officers. Well, as of last week, March 1st, the officers' names were taken off. Based upon a new rule that the judiciary imposed.
They caused quite a stir.
It did cause quite a stir, and there were some lawmakers or some law enforcement who apparently complained about it, though we never really found out which ones.
That's mysterious.
Now we hear from Judge Alan Wilner, who's the chair of the court's rules committee. He sent a letter today to the Court of Appeals to say that that rule was a mistake, and they're going to reconsider, possibly rescind it, at a meeting tomorrow.
Look, I think most of the public, in the air of the nationally very horrific case of the Gun Trace Task Force unit, the fact that we are not being as transparent as possible when it comes to public information like police officers' names, to try to be opaque with that is the exact opposite direction the judiciary should be taking. So tomorrow there's supposed to be a hearing around this, but I would like to know more. If I was still in the legislature, which I'm not, I would be asking questions, how did this happen? Because, Robert, how can we prevent it from happening in the future if we don't know how it actually happened? Mistake? Really?
Yeah.
I'm kind of jaundiced on that.
You're feeling better?
I am here. Nasal surgery, endoscopic sinus surgery, as well as I'm getting these auricular lesion removal from my ear.
Wow.
All that having been said, thank you to all the doctors that helped me return so I could be a big mouth from 9 to 1.
Auricular lesion free C4 back tomorrow
morning. And cookies from Mrs. Lang. I'm going to say that.
Back tomorrow morning,
thank you,
9
Robert.
To 1 on WBAL News Radio 1090.